do is today we'll start with simple interest, compound interest. Okay, since that is something that you might already be aware from your okay. So in simple interest, compound interest that you have in your syllabus, the things that you need to remember is okay. So these are the two concepts that you have. Okay, one is basic concepts of simple interest, compound interest. That means the exercise 1 and the exercise 2 that you have in the chapter will essentially focus on the simple concepts of simple interest and compound interest. And then you also have something called as annuity, if you see. So annuity essentially deals with your future concepts and present value and future value. And please remember, whatever you are learning in the annuity part of your simple interest, compound interest, that is something that you carry in your IPCC also when you read some finance related stuff also, right? So whatever you are reading in the second part of the session, it will be very useful for you further. Whatever you are looking in the first is something that is a continuation of what you have already learned in school. Okay, so what we are trying to understand is, first we need to understand the basic difference between these two. Okay, or for example, in I'll give you two examples. Okay, first example, let us assume I deposit, okay, 100 rupees, okay, I deposit 100 rupees in a bank, let us say Andhra Bank, and the rate of interest they are paying is 10% and the time period is 3 years. So these are all the terminology that you will come across. One is they will say principal, then there is a time period, then there is a rate of interest, and there is something called as an amount. So for example, today I go and deposit 100 rupees in Andhra Bank and they say the rate of interest is 10% and the time that I have is 3 years. Okay, that means I deposited today, that means 2017 August, and I have the facility of withdrawing this amount in 2020. So essentially I have 3 year period, 2017 to 18 18 to 19 and 19 to 20. So I have 3 years, right? So assuming this is a fixed deposit, okay, that means for example you don't have the option of withdrawing in between. That means once you put in the money, it is freezed for the next 3 years. So today I am going to deposit 100 rupees and they pay rate of interest continuously 10%, 10%, 10% for 3 years. And after 3 years, that means in 2020 August on the same day, I can withdraw my amount. So how much money will I be eligible to get on the same day after 3 years? If I deposit 100 today and rate of interest is 10%, how much will I get after 3 years? So, or tell me, which concept should I use? Should I use simple interest or should I use compound interest? Simple interest, okay. So, what is the formula for simple interest? Simple interest is equal to PTR by 100 or PNR by 100. Whether you use T or whether you use R, both are one and the same in our representation. So, in this case, now the terms that you are associated is, one is called the principal. So whenever I am using the word principal, it means the money that you either deposit somewhere or the money that you borrow from someone, the money that is exchanging hand today, whether it is withdrawal or whether it is deposit, that is called principal. Then you have time. So time, in all the problems that we are discussing, whether it is simple interest, compound interest, time should always be measured in terms of years. For example, if I give you 18 months, instead of saying fixed deposit is for 3 years, if I say it is 18 months, so what value will you put in place of T? Yeah, so you need to convert this into years. That means you have to divide this value by 12 and accordingly you should put as 3 by 2, 6 3s are 6 2s are, or you can put 1.5. So whenever you are using any of the formulas of simple interest or compound interest, please ensure that you always put years wherever you have T or N. That is the first thing. And the third part is what is called as R, which is called rate of interest, small r. Okay, so whenever I am using the word rate of interest, please remember it is always given, they will say P dot A dot. What does P dot A dot represent? Per annum. That means whenever I say rate of interest is 10%, that means if you have deposited your amount for the entire 1 year, you are eligible to get 10%. For example, if I withdraw the amount after 6 months only, that means due to some reason, personal reason, I want the money back desperately, I have some medical emergency, so I go to bank and withdraw the, close the thing, and I want to withdraw after 6 months exactly. So how much will the bank pay me with after 6 months? In that 6 months, it will not pay me 10% because the rate of interest is always computed for 1 year. So instead of paying it 10%, it will pay for the time period for which you invested. Because this 10% they promise to pay is for 12 months, right? Since you have withdrawn it only after 6 months, so you have deposited only for half the time, so they will pay you only 5% logically. That means if you want to withdraw the money after 6 months, effectively you will be getting only 5% interest. So these are all the basic terms. One is principal, one is the time period, always in years, rate of interest is always given per annum, and simple interest. Interest means the amount that gets accumulated on your deposit or the extra money that you pay on the money that you borrow. Okay. So this is what simple interest means. So in this case, if I am using simple interest, since I deposited 100 rupees, the time that I have invested is for 3 years and the rate of interest they promised to pay me is 10%, effectively this value will give me 30 rupees. So after depositing 100 rupees, it is saying that I am eligible to get an interest of 30 rupees. So at the end of 3 years, I should be in a position to earn 130 rupees. This is called as amount. Amount. Amount means the money that you end up paying after you have taken a loan, or the money that you get after you have deposited for 3 years. That is something that happens in future. Remember, principal is something that will change hands today. Whether you deposit or whether you withdraw, the transaction is happening today. Amount is something that you pay either in installments or in one go in future. So that is a basic difference. Because in annuity, you also have the concept of present value and future value. You should understand principal is something that is changing hands today, and amount is something that is changing hands in future. Maybe tomorrow or day after, after 1 year, after 5 years or 10 years accordingly, right? Now in this case, how do we get it as 130? We generally say amount is equal to principal plus interest. Principal is something that you have deposited. Interest is something that bank is paying you. So it is paying you 130 rupees. But here what we need to remember is the transaction that you have assumed, you are saying it follows the concept of simple interest. So if I am looking at the same transaction in a step by step manner, that means I have computed this entirely for 3 years. If I want to do the same calculation 1 year at a time, for example, let me start with 100 rupees. So let me see what is happening in year 1, right? So year 1, I deposited this 100 rupees. So in year 1, I am eligible to get 10% on this value. So effectively 10% means 10 rupees. So at the end of 1 year, if I want to withdraw, if it's a possibility, if I want to withdraw, I am eligible to get 110. Fair enough. But I am not withdrawing, so I am continuing it for the next year also. So now coming to year 2. That means 2018 to 2019. 17 to 18 is over. Now I am getting to 18 to 19. Now the challenge is, will the bank pay me interest on this 100 or should it pay me interest on this 110? 110. Because you have not withdrawn this 10 rupees that you have earned. So effectively, if you are still, what that calculation tells you is that you are getting interest only on 100. Because the 30 rupees is split into 10, 10, 10 for 3 years. So effectively what you are saying, you are not paying me interest on the amount that I am earning extra. So had you, this 110 is a breakup of 100 and 10 rupees. So if you are saying next year it will become 120, your basic assumption is again on this 100, you are getting 10 rupees. So this 110 is becoming 120. What we are ignoring this value completely. So in a simple interest, the basic fundamental is interest is always paid on the original principal. What 130 you told me, that is only under the assumption that interest is always paid on this value. But actually speaking, that will not exist in real life, because simple interest is not logical if you see this calculation. That means what any logical customer would say, I want you to pay interest on this value because I have not withdrawn the 10 rupees. So effectively you have to pay me interest on this 100 as well as this 10 rupees. I want interest on both. So effectively he will say, okay, you pay me 10% on this value, which is my original deposit. At the same time, you also need to pay me 10% on this value because I have not withdrawn this. Or effectively he will say, pay me interest on the entire value because I am not withdrawing it. So effectively you end up paying 10% of this value, which is how much? 11 rupees. 10% means you just have to remove 10 from this calculation. So effectively at the end of second year, you might end up getting 110 21. Where is the difference? In that case, you will only get 120 rupees. So, there is a basic difference. Now, moving to the third year. Year 3, again you will get 10%. So, now the 10% that the bank is going to pay you, will it pay you on 100, 110 or 121? 121. Because that is called what is called as outstanding value. So, this is what is called as outstanding value. So, the interest will always be paid on the outstanding value. So, what is 10% of this value? 1 point you move to the left side. 12 rupees 10 paise. So, effectively you will get 121 plus 12 rupees 10 paise. You should get 133 rupees 10 paise. Assuming there is no cutting, no tax or something, no TDS or something. So, you should end up getting this complete value. So, the basic difference what you need to understand in simple interest and compound interest is, in simple interest, the principal will remain same for every year, which is the original value. In compound interest, the difference is the amount at the end of first year. What is the amount at the end of first year in my calculation? 110 will become the principal for the second year. So, what is the principal for second year? 110. Now, what is the amount at the end of second year? 121. That will become principal for the third year. So, effectively, whatever is the outstanding value, that will keep generating you the interest. Or think this way. For example, you take a housing loan or you take a car loan or let us take, you take some personal loan. For example, if I have taken a lump sum value of, let us say, 20 lakhs. Okay. So, 20 lakhs you have taken as a loan. Let us say from ICICI Bank today, okay, for personal use, you have taken 20 lakhs as a loan. So, bank is saying they are going to charge you 12% on this loan, 20 lakhs that you have taken from ICICI Bank, okay. Let us assume you have borrowed it today and due to some whatever is the money that you need to get from someone else, let us say you got 5 lakhs in this month from your friend or someone, let us say you get 5 lakhs. Now, at the end of the month, when ICICI Bank is computing the interest on whatever money that you have borrowed, will it compute on 20 lakhs or will it compute on 15 lakhs? Now, the challenge is the interest when you are depositing the amount or whether whenever they are calculating on your loan is always calculated on the outstanding value. For example, if you see, whenever you the structure of EMI, okay, whenever you take a loan, housing loan, you see whenever they actually give you the EMI concept, that EMI is split in two parts. One is the principal, one is the interest. And EMI is always computing of two. So, whenever in the initial days of payment, you will see the interest component will be high in that EMI and the principal component will be low. For example, if I take a housing loan and let us say every month I have to pay 50,000 rupees to a bank. If you try to see what is the breakup of this 50,000 rupees, for example, initial days may you might have 35,000 rupees as the interest and 15,000 rupees as the principal. How they will come across this, we'll discuss. But the challenge is, as you, if you see, this is the EMI breakup in the current month. If you see the EMI breakup next month, it will become 34,500, 15,500. If you see after 1 year, this will become 30,000, this will become 20,000. So, after 5 years, interest will become 10,000 and principal will become 40,000. So, the difference is as you keep paying, the loan amount will come down. As you keep paying, the loan amount will come down. So, the interest is always calculated on the outstanding value. So, whether you deposit any amount or whether you take a loan, deposit is the first scenario, loan is the second scenario. In general, it is always compound interest. There is no concept of simple interest that exists. And unless otherwise specified, all the financial transactions, whether you are taking money or whether you are depositing money, it always follows the concept of compound interest. Okay, that is what you need to remember. Okay, so if I want to compute what is the value of this transaction without using this step-by-step formula, you have a formula which already of you are aware. What is the formula for compound interest? Amount is equal to principal into 1 plus r by 100 whole power t or n, whatever you may write. Or in your textbook, probably they would have written p into 1 plus I whole power n or t. Right. So, what this indicate, simple interest is equal to ptr by 100 is your basic formula for simple interest. Whenever you use principal, whenever you put the value of time in years, whenever you use the rate of interest, you will get the simple interest. And simple interest, when you add the principal, you will get the final amount. In case of compound interest, there is only one formula which will give you the direct amount, which is principal into 1 plus r by 100 whole power n or t. So in this case, what I am trying to do, I have deposited 100 rupees in the bank. Bank is claiming that it will pay me 10% interest, and I have deposited it for 3 years. So whenever you use this calculation, which is 100 into 1 plus 10 by 100, which is 1.1 whole power 3, whenever you are computing this using your calculator, you will end up getting the same value, which is 133.1. As simple as that, right? So the difference that you need to keep in mind is, in simple interest, the principal will always remain same, but in case of compound interest, it will keep changing, because whatever is the outstanding value, this will become the new principal. That is the reason, with every passing year, you will see, as you can see, 100, 110, 120, 130. This is the pattern in case of simple interest, whatever we have discussed. But in case of compound interest, first year 100 has become 110. So there is no change in simple and compound interest for first year. But in case of second year, your value will become 121. Obviously, you can see a difference here. And after second year, you have seen it is 133.1. So this is a further difference. So as time progresses, you will see the difference between compound interest and simple interest will keep increasing substantially, because whatever money is getting accumulated, that is also generating you more interest. Okay, so that is the basic difference between simple interest and compound interest. Now the challenge is, there might be cases where you are doing compounding more than one time in a year. That is the second concept. That means whatever we have discussed in case of compound interest, so whatever we have seen, amount is equal to principal into 1 plus r by 100 whole power n. You see, p into 1 plus r by 100 whole power n, or p into 1 plus I whole power n. I is nothing but r by 100. Okay. If the rate of interest is 10%, I value will become 10 by 100, which is 0.1. Okay. So you can use either of the two formula. Anything is okay. Now the situation here is, how do I look at the situation where you are doing compounding more than one time in a year? For example, I have two scenarios. Okay. So scenario one, let us say you have borrowed 100 rupees from a money lender. You have borrowed 100 rupees. Rate of interest is 10% per annum. Okay. Time is, let us say, 1 year. That means you have borrowed 100 rupees today, and the rate of interest is going to charge you is 10% per annum, and the time which is given to you to repay is 1 year. So let us assume we have two scenarios. Scenario one, where I am doing compounding yearly. What does compounding yearly means? That means the interest on the principal is calculated one time in a year. Second situation, I am doing compounding, for example, to make life easy, let us say half yearly. Then we can also look at quarterly. Okay. Now I am doing compounding half yearly. That means the interest is calculated how many times in a year? Two times. Instead of doing it once, I am doing it twice. So in these situations, we have already seen how much will you end up paying after the end of first year. If in this case, if you are borrowing 100 rupees, rate of interest is 10%, time is 1 year, how much will you repay after 1 year? 110, which is plain simple. So because in the first year, there is no difference between simple and compound interest, both are one and the same. Now the situation will differ when I am doing compounding half yearly. So the case here is, that means for the first, that means I am splitting this into 6 months and 6 months. So in financial calculation, they will say H1 and H2. H1 means first half of the year, H2 means second half of the year. That means I am splitting this interest component into two parts. So first I take 100 rupees, for example, let me take American system, let us say January to June. Okay, then I will have July to December. Let me take it this way, American system of accounting. So if I am taking January to June, in the first half of this year, that means for the first 6 months, how much interest will they charge me on the principal? Because the rate of interest is 10% per annum, ideally in the first half, they should charge me 5%, because the time period is only 6 months, but the rate of interest is 1 year, so they will end up charging me 5%. So after the end of 6 months, for example, if I want to repay it due to some reason, how much will I pay? 105, which is 5% of 100, which is 5 into 100 by 100, which is 5 rupees. Now, the difference here is, if I don't pay it at the end of 6 months, now there is a second period which has already started. Now, they will charge the interest on 100 or will they charge interest on 105? 105. Because the compounding is done 2 times in a year. After the first compounding is done, 100 has already become 105 since you have not repaid. Now, the new rate of interest, which is again 5%, is computed not on 100, but it is on 105. So, if I want to adjust the same in this formula without getting into any calculation, big calculation, what I will do is, amount is equal to, principal will not change, which is the same 100 rupees. Here, since the rate of interest is computed for every 6 months, instead of taking R as 10%, since you are doing compounding 2 times, you need to divide this by 2. Whatever is the value of R, you need to divide it by 2. How many times you are doing compounding? 2 times. If I am doing quarterly, what will you put here? 4. If I am doing monthly, what will you put here? 12. So, that way you need to adjust this R. Okay. By 100, there is no change. How many compoundings you are doing? 2. So, whatever is the value that you get here, 1 year, because the total time is 1 year, in 1 year, how many times you are doing? 2. So, whatever you divide here, you need to multiply here, so that the formula gets balanced. If I am doing compoundings X times in a year, I will put X here and I will multiply with X. If I am doing compounding monthly, I will put 12 here, 12. What does this indicate? How many compoundings you are doing? What does this indicate? What is the compounding for each period? If I am doing compounding quarterly, what does it indicate? The rate of interest they are going to charge me is only 2.5%. How many 2.5%? 4 times I need to pay, because every quarter I am computing. So, whatever you are dividing here, you need to multiply to balance your equation. So, effectively, if you do by 2 into 2, whatever computation we have done there, you will end up getting the same answer. Okay. So, that is the difference where compounding is done, not full year, but half year. Now, what is the application of this? Okay. Why is this compounding being done more than one time a year is relevant. For example, you take the best example of stock market. Okay, which is a closest example that you can get. Assuming that values are increasing consistently, assuming, okay, because they can also come down. Assuming that values are consistently increasing, it's a good example of compounding happening every moment. It may be every 1 second, or it may be every 2 seconds or 3 seconds. This formula will continuously be applicable. So, if you take the compounding being done for every second, then this is like an infinite compounding, which is continuously increasing. Or for example, in science, you have something called as nuclear fission. In physics, you have something called as nuclear fission. That means that value will keep multiplying fast. That is the best example of compounding happening every moment. So, the basic concept is, what is the formula for simple interest, which is PTR by 100? What is the formula for compound interest? Amount is equal to principal into 1 plus R by 100 whole power n. And the situation is, what is the case of compounding done more than once in a year, and how do you adjust that formula? So, these are the basic stuff which you require to solve your first 2 exercises, 1 and 2. Okay. So, let's start working on some problems. Okay. So, you can open your textbooks. At the same time, we look at some basic other stuff before you can work on your problems. Okay. Okay. So I'll give you a question. So, please note down. Okay, just note down, a money invested in a financial instrument doubled in 3 years. Full stop. In how many years will how many years, in how many years will the investment, in how many years will the investment become, in how many years will the investment become 8 times, in how many years will the investment become 8 times the original value. So, I am saying a money invested in a financial instrument doubles in 3 years. In how many years will the investment become 8 times the original value? So, there are 2 cases here, case 1 and case 2. So, case 1 is the investment is done under simple interest, because I never specified what kind of system you need to follow. I never told you whether it is simple interest or compound interest. Case 1 is where I have invested in simple interest. Case 2 is where I have invested in compound interest. So, obviously both will differ. So, even before you getting into the answer, tell me in which case will it become 8 times faster, in simple interest or compound interest? Compound interest, obviously there should be a difference. And what in this case now, if you see, I have not specified what is the value of R, which is rate of interest. I never specified. All I told you is, if you invested some value, let us say X, it became, it doubled. So, if you invested P, it became 2P, or if you invested 100 rupees, it became 200 rupees in how many years? Yeah, this is what I have shown. I want this value to become what? 8X. So, you tell me, if this original investment, if it is becoming twice in 3 years, and if I want this investment to become 8x or 800 or 8000, whatever is it, how many years will it take if I am following the first route, which is simple interest, and in how many years will it become 8 times if I am following the compound interest route? So, you tell me, in how many years will it happen in simple interest, and how many years will it happen under compound interest? Do it. In how many years will your x become 2x? Sorry, x become 8x under simple interest, and in how many years will it become 8x under compound interest? So, as you told, ideally it should become 8x faster in this case compared to this case. So, you need to ask yourself what is happening in this transaction. So, in this transaction, what is the money that you invested? X. And how much you got back after 3 years? 2x. So, essentially we call it as principal. We call this as amount. So, what is the difference between these two?
Interest.
Interest, which is X. So, after investing X, you got 2X, means how much extra money you earned?
X.
Or if I want to use the formula approach, simple interest is equal to PTR by 100. Okay. What is the principal that you invested? X. What is the time for which you invested? 3 years. What is the rate of interest? I did not mention, we keep it as R by 100. You invested X and you got 2X. So, the extra money that you got is another X. Here you have to put only the interest, not the amount. So, essentially you will get some value of R is equal to 100 by 3. Don't cancel it, keep it as it is. Now, you got the rate of interest, which is 100 by 3. Keep it separate. Now, you want the X to become how much? 8X. So, how much extra interest you want to earn? 7x, because you have invested 100 and you want 800. So, effectively you are generating an interest of 700. So, if I were to use the same formula, which is 7x is equal to x, which is your original investment, into what is the time for which you invest, that is what I want to find out, into r. What is the rate of interest that you computed? 100 by 3 by 100. Agreed? So, P T R by 100. That means effectively you will get T is equal to 7 into 3, 21 years. Or if I have to make your life simple, if you see in the earlier case, when I invested 100 rupees in the first example that we discussed, you said it becomes 130. If it is simple interest, that means you said first year it will become 110, second year it will become 120, and third year it will become 130. That means the interest that is generated in year 1 is 10 rupees, second year it is 10 rupees, third year also it is 10 rupees. Or interest generated for first year 10 rupees, interest generated for 2 years 20 rupees, interest generated for 3 years, 30 rupees. That means if you generate 10 rupees for year 1 or first year, if I want to ask you how much interest will you generate for 2 years, you will do 2 into 10, which is 20. If I ask you how much interest will you generate in 5 years, you will say it is 50 rupees. So here also, what is the interest that you generated initially? X rupees. In how many years? 3 years. Now how much interest you need to generate? 7x. If x rupees is taking 3 years, how many years will 7x take? 21 years. So you don't require this computation also, because it's like a direct proportionality. If you want more interest, it will take more time. It's called direct proportionality, right? So if you invest 1 and it becomes 2, that means additional money that you generated is 1, which is x, which is taking 3 years. And if you want the same 1 to become 8, that means you want to generate extra 7 rupees. So if x is taking 3 years, 7x will take 7 into 3, which is 21 years, which is your basic calculation. Now obviously I realize that in case of compound interest, this value will be less than 21. Now the question is how less. Now you know how to use the formula for compound interest. What is the formula for compound interest? Amount is equal to P into 1 plus. So you just substitute these two values in this formula first. Okay. Yeah, so what should I put on my left hand side? 2x, because that is your final value, right? What is the principal? X into 1 plus R, I don't know. What is the value of N? 3 years. So I have invested for 3 years. So just like I have found out the value of R here, from this equation also I will find out what is the value of R if required, or otherwise I will just keep it as it is. Now if you see, if I cancel this X and X, I am getting 1 plus R by 100 whole power 3 is equal to 2. Now if I want to find out what is the value of R, this will become cube root if it goes to the right hand side, which is very time consuming. So let's not disturb this, let's keep this as it is without making any changes. Now see what is happened in the second case. Now your x should become what in the second case? 8x. If I want to use the same formula, how do I write it? Amount is equal to principal into 1 plus R by 100 whole power n. This is what I want to find out. Agreed? N or T, whatever you may call it. Now, to compute this value, I require this value. Just like in the previous problem, what I have done. Now, let me cancel the x, because x is immaterial here, because it is 8 times. Now, if you see 8 is equal to 1 plus R by 100 whole power n. So, what am I trying to find out? I am trying to find out what is the value of this n. You will get the value of n only if you put the value of R. You will get the value of R only if you simplify that equation, which is 1 plus R by 100 whole power 3 is equal to 2. Now instead of simplifying it using cube root, what I will do, I will write this 8 as in power of 2, where in place of 2 I can easily substitute it. It's only for convenience, which is nothing but 1 plus R by 100 whole power n. So in place of 2, what can I substitute? 1 plus R by 100 whole power 3. 1 plus R by 100 whole power 3. So you know this is of the form a power m whole power n, which will save you lots of indices. So what is a power m whole power n? A power m into n. So which is effectively 3 into 3. How much? 9. So 1 plus R by 100 whole power 9 is equal to 1 plus R by 100 whole power n. Since the bases are same, you can easily say the value of n is equal to 9, as simple as that. So that is how you can compute this very simply, right? Otherwise you need to do lot of adjustment, or you apply log, which you learn in logarithm. Those are not required. Okay, whenever I am doing such calculation, this is what is going to help you simply. So from this entire example, what you need to understand, whatever time it takes in simple interest, in compounds obviously it will take less time, because you have the effect of compounding. Okay, right? So let me give you another question. Okay, this will be a pure compound interest question. Okay, so just note down. Okay, money invested in a financial instrument becomes 1440. Money invested in a financial instrument becomes 1440 at the end of 2 years. At the end of 2 years, and becomes, that means the same amount, becomes 1728 at the end of 3 years. So, a money invested in a financial instrument becomes 1440 at the end of 2 years and 1728 at the end of 3 years. Okay, this is all compound interest. Okay, full stop. Now, the question is, there are three parts here. Okay, two parts. You have to tell me what is the value of R, your first question. What is the rate of interest? Second question, what is the principal? These are the two items that you have to tell me. You have to tell me what is the rate of interest. At the same time, you have to tell me what is the principal. I told you this is the case of compound interest. I didn't tell you the principal. What are the values 1440 and 1728? Amount at the end of 2 years and amount at the end of 3 years. So, effectively you have to use this formula how many times? 2 times. So, use your formula 2 times, and since the two unknowns are rate of interest and whatever is that value, you will get the answer. So, use this formula, amount is equal to principal into 1 plus R by 100 whole power n 2 times, and tell me what is the rate of interest that I am charging and what is the principal that I have deposited, both. You got two equations, so you will get the answer easily. Rate of interest as well as the principal, both. So, you need to compute what is the money that you invested, that is the principal, and what is the rate of interest they are paying you. So, if I am using that formula, if I want to use, see, this is what is happening. You invested some value, it will increase by some R percent in the first year, which is the interest, and it becomes some value, which I don't know. Again, on this, they will pay the second year interest, because they will not pay on this, because this compound interest. So, whatever is the value that is coming here, on this, they will again pay you some interest, and it becomes 1440. Again on this, they will pay some interest and then it becomes 1728. This is what I am looking at, line by line. Now, if I want to use this formula, amount is equal to principal into 1 plus R by 100 whole power n. If I want to use this as to write my first equation, so how do I write? What should I write? 1440 is equal to P, I don't know, P into 1 plus R by 100 whole power 2. Agreed? Whenever I am using the word amounts to, whenever you have this word in your question, means I am referring to amount. Or whenever I am using the word it becomes, means I am referring to the amount. So, this is the two terminology that you will come across. Whenever I use the word amounts to, means I started and it became indirectly. So, 1440 is equal to principal into 1 plus R by 100 whole power 2, which is fair enough, but you have two unknowns, so you cannot simplify. If I want to write the equation using this value, what should I write? 1728 is equal to P into 1 plus R by 100 whole power 3. Now, effectively you have two unknowns, principal and rate of interest, and two equations. So what would I do? The best option in this case should be, what should I do with them? We'll simply divide these two, because at the same way you can cancel. If I subtract, nothing will get cancelled. So the best option will be to divide these two equations, which is 1440 divided by 1728 is equal to, if you divide this by this, P and P will get cancelled, 1 by 1 plus R by 100. Power 2 by power 3, so 2 will get cancelled, you are left with only power 1. Make it reverse, or instead of doing that, divide this by this, or once you divide this by this, make this inverse. So I will write 1728 by 1440 is equal to 1 plus R by 100 whole power 1 by 1. By 1 is immaterial. Now you can easily simplify this. You can take this 1 to the left hand side, which will become 1728 by 1440 minus 1 is equal to R by 100. Now you simplify and tell me what is the value of R that you are getting. Once you simplify and take LCM, simplify and tell me what is the value of R that you are getting, which is nothing but the rate of interest. How much? 20. Cool. 20%, right? So what you are doing in this case, 1728 minus 1 by 1440. If I am doing the simplification here, 1728 minus 1 by 1440 is equal to R by 100. So either you can cancel it here or take LCM, whichever you feel comfortable. 1728 minus 1440 by 1440 is equal to R by 100. If you subtract these two, how much you are getting? 288 by 1440 is equal to R by 100. So 1 get cancelled. 144, if you just do double, you will get 288. So this will go exactly 2 times. So R is equal to 2 into 10, which is 20%. So the rate of interest that you are getting is nothing but 20%, or the one they are charging, which is 20%. Now you got the value of R. Now the next question is, I have to compute what is the value of P. So either you can put the value of R here, or you will get the value, put the value of R here, you will get the value of P. But for ensuring that calculation becomes easy, put the value of R in this equation, which will make it easy. So to get the value of P, what will I do? I will just write 1440 is equal to P into 1 plus 20 by 100 whole power 2. 20 by 100 you can cancel if you feel like simplifying. 21s are 20. Instead of expanding it, you can cancel it. So 1440 is equal to P into 1 plus 1 by 5. 6 by 5, 2 times. So 6 by 5 into 6 by 5. Agreed? So you can just move it this side. So the value of principal will become 1440 into 5 by 6 into 5 by 6. Or you can simplify it, send it one go. 6 by 5, 36 by 25. If it goes here, it will become 25 by 36, just inverse. Now you can cancel. Obviously, you can see that this will get cancelled in 6 table. Only then you will get the answer, which is, okay. So 40 into 5, 200, 200 into 5, 1000. So the money that you invested is how much? 1000 rupees. So you got what is the value that you have invested. You also got what is the rate of interest. And you know how to compute these values, okay, right? Compound interest may, these are the kind of questions that you might get, which you should be prepared, okay, right? So all you need to do is just write down these equations comfortably and get the value of rate of interest, okay? So just open your material. Let us see if you have any questions which follow the same pattern, okay? So you open your exercise 1 in simple interest, compound interest. So initial exercise will have lot of questions on simple interest, which we will try to cover, and once you are comfortable, we will move to the compound interest part, okay? Just give me a moment. So look at your exercise 4A. You look at exercise 4A. So 4A may you have 10 questions. Okay. So all these 10 questions are essentially the basic questions which are there on simple interest. And next exercise 4B is essentially focused on compound interest. So let us look at simple interest questions. So please start with solving question number 8th one. So look at question number 8, all of you. Whenever I am using the word sum, please remember sum also means principal. Sum means always principal, okay, right? So the question is, the sum required to earn a monthly interest of rupees 1200 at 18% per annum SI is. So in all the first 10 questions, I am only using one formula, SI is equal to PTR by 100. Okay, just look at question number 8. Okay, fine. He is asking you to find out what is the principal. He told you what is the interest, and he told you what is the rate of interest also. So what would be your answer? How do you compute? The sum required to earn a monthly interest of 1200 at 18% per annum simple interest is. Please remember, this 1200 is for the entire year or is it for 1 month?
1 month.
1 month. So effectively, if you want to use the formula I is equal to PTR by 100, simple interest is equal to PTR by 100. Now it's up to you how you are going to use this. Now if you want to put the, what is the rate of interest given?
18%.
Now whenever you are putting the value of R for the one full year, even the interest value that you are putting should also be for one full year. Only then it is justified. So what is the interest that he is saying you are getting per month?
1200.
So effectively you need to multiply this with 12. Every month you are getting 1200. So effectively either you compute this for 1 year, then you want to find out what is the principal. Time is nothing but 1 year. The rate of interest is nothing but 18% by 100. So either do this, which is the best way to do, because if you are putting the value of R as 18% for one full year, even the simple interest also should be put for one full year, because you cannot put it only for 1 month. So R is equal to 100 into 1200 into 12 divided by 18. Final simplification, whatever is the value. Okay. I think they should get cancelled. 6 2s are, 6 3s are, 3 goes 400. Yeah. 80,000. 100 into 400, 40,000 into 2, which is 80,000, which is perfect. Okay. That means if you want this, you have to invest how much? 80,000. Agreed? So the only adjustment that you need to make in this question is, instead of putting the value as 1200 on the LHS, you have to put 1200 into 12, because the interest is given only for 1 month. Okay. Now if you are insisting that I will use only 1200 and I don't want to use 1200 into 12, I am okay with that. There is no issue. But you need to convert everything into 1 month simplification only. Right? You can either do it for one full year as we have done it, or you can simplify this only for 1 month. So if I want to do it for only 1 month, how do I change my equation? So LHS interest is for 1 month. What is the principal? I will compute. What is the time? 1 month. Or what should I put? Should I put 1 by 12 or 1? 1 by 12. Because time is always given in years, which I will put 1 by 12. So what should I put as the value of R? 18 by 12. Everyone agrees with this? By 100. You make this adjustment. Either way you will get the same answer. But to make your life simple, this is a much better way of looking at than this one. But if you want to do it for 1 month also, I am okay. But you have to put everywhere, you have to use 1 month only. 1 month, 1 month, 1 month. Everywhere you have to use it, you will end up getting the same question. Okay. So let me give you one question which is not there in your material. Okay. Let us give you a case and I will wait if you can answer this. Okay. Right. So note down this question. Okay. A father has two sons, Rohit and Ranjit. Okay. A father has two sons, Rohit and Ranjit, with age 12 years and 15 years respectively. A father has two sons, Rohit and Ranjit, with age 12 years and 15 years respectively. That means today, their age is 12 years and 15 years. Full stop. Okay. He has 27 lakhs. He has 27 lakhs with him. He has 27 lakhs with him and divides the money equally among his two children. He has 27 lakhs with him and he divides the money equally among his two children. Full stop. Okay. He plans to invest this money. That means their individual money. He plans to invest this money under simple interest, such that he plans to invest this money under simple interest such that both his sons get 21 lakh rupees. Both his sons get 21 lakh rupees each. Both his sons get 21 lakh rupees each when they complete 21 years. Okay, you understood? I have 27 lakhs rupees with me and I divide the money equally among my two sons, and the first son's age is 12 years, the second son's age is 15 years, and by the time my first son reach 21 years, he should be left with 21 lakhs. Similarly, when my second son, who is age 15, he reaches 21 years, he should also be left with 21 lakh rupees. Full stop. The question is, what is the rate at which I invested? What is the rate at which I invested separately? That means you have to find out what is the value of R1. That means what is the rate of interest that I have invested for my first son, and what is the value of R2, the rate of interest that I invested for my second son. So effectively, the money that I invested is 27 lakhs. I distributed them equally between my two sons. So that means 13,50,000. 13,50,000. So this 13,50,000 should become how much? 21 lakhs. In how many years? What is the age of my first son? 9 or 15, whichever is the first son. So that means if I am looking at it, this 13.5 lakhs should become how much? 21 lakhs. In how many years? First case. Similarly, the remaining part, which is the second equal part, which is 13.5 lakhs, this should also become how much? How many years? 6 years. So you compute, if 13.5 lakhs has to become 21 lakhs in 9 years, what is the rate of interest? And if this 13.5 lakhs should become 21 lakhs in 6 years, what is the rate of interest? You decide. But I am telling you, this is simple interest. So first tell me whether R1 will be more or R2 will be more. Whether the value of R1 should be more or R2 should be more? Logically. Think, 13.5 lakhs is becoming 21 lakhs. The time that you have is 9 years. But 13.5 lakhs should become 21 lakhs only in 6 years. So in which case the value of R should be more? R1 or R2? R2. Because you want the money to increase faster, that means this value should be more. You have 9 years time for this value to become 21. So it can grow slowly. But whereas this value has to become 21 in only 6 years, so obviously this has to be more. So when you compute, ensure that whatever value you get, you verify whether the value of R2 that you are getting is greater than R1 or not, logically. Okay. So this is pure simple interest question. So how you are going to use, I leave it to you, but you need to get me an answer. What is the value of, what is the rate of interest for Rohit, and what is the value of R for Ranjit? Yeah. So what is the rate of interest for Rohit and how much is it for Ranjit? So except the value of R, you have everything that you require. You have what is the principal, you know what is the amount, you also know what is the time. So you just need to put those values and get the value of R, as simple as that. So I am going to use PTR by 100 or PNR by 100. So what is the age of Rohit currently? 12. So the time he has for this value to become 21 is how many years? 9. This guy will have only 6 years. Now whenever I am using this formula, simple interest is equal to PTR by 100, for example for Rohit, right? So what is the value of principal? How much money invested? 13,50,000. What is the time for which I invested? 9 years. I want to compute this value by 100. So what should I put on my LHS? How much value should I put on my LHS? Simple interest. 21 lakhs is the money that you get after 9 years. As I told you, this is not the interest, this is the amount. How much you invested? 13,50,000. How much you get? 21 lakhs. So what is the difference between these two? 7,50,000. That is what you will put. That is the difference between simple interest and compound interest. In compound interest, directly the formula gives you A. But in case of simple interest, there is no A. You have invested this much and you got this much. So what is the extra you got? That is only is the interest, right? Because that is what I am emphasizing. Because the formula is nothing but only for interest, not for the amount. You invested 13,50,000 for Rohit. And after 9 years, he is getting 21 lakhs. So the extra money that you earned is nothing but your interest. Interest is equal to principal into time into rate of interest by 100. With this you will get what is the value of R. Yeah. Which one? This value of R. This is coming 6.17. Okay, let me check. So R is equal to 7,50,000 into 100 divided by 13,50,000 into 9. Okay. So 4 zeros and 4 zeros will get cancelled. 15 table, 15 goes 5 times. And 15 goes 9 times. So 7,50,000 into 100 divided by 13,50,000 into 9. So how much we are getting? 500 by 81, which is 6. Fair enough. Whatever is it. You understood how we are doing it? All you need to understand is why you are putting this value here and why not the complete value. That is what I want you to think. Otherwise, the calculation way, there is no difference at all. Okay. So, whatever is the money that you have invested, how much extra interest you want to earn and how it is happening, it is as simple. So, for Ranjit, instead of 9, you put 6 here, you will get a different answer, as simple as that. Okay. Right. You understood? So, this is what is happening in case of simple interest, where on the LHS you will only put this value, not the full value, because this is the interest component. Okay. Right. Okay. So, how much money was it divided? How much is it? Is the total money they have? 27 lakhs. Okay. Fair enough. Cool. Okay. Right. So, if you look at your first exercise, that means exercise 4A, please look at question number 6. Please look at question number 6. Question number 6. Question number 6. Once you are done with 6, look at question number 7. Both question number 6 and 7. Okay. So, effectively remember, in this formula you have 4 unknowns: simple interest, principal, time and rate of interest. So, if you want to find out any one variable, 3 values has to be given. So, in all the questions that you have, you see there are 3 values given. So, once you substitute any 3, the 4th one will automatically come. Okay. Right. So, what is the answer for 7th one? Sorry, 6th one. 2 years. Everyone? 2 years? Okay. So, what you need to do? P is equal to 10,000 in the given formula. So, what is the value of SI given? 2500. Principal invested is 10,000. Time period is? Time is what you have to find out. Rate of interest is? Is it per annum? 12.5% per annum divided by 100. So, you just find out what is the value of T. 2500 divided by 1250. 12.5 into 100, 1250. 2500 divided by 1250 is nothing but 2 years. Okay. Fair enough. Next, once you are done with 6th one, move on to 7th question. So, in some cases he will directly give you the interest, like problem number 6. In 7th question, instead of giving you interest, he will give you the amount. So, he is giving you one more additional computation where you have to find out the interest on your own and then substitute in the formula. Right? 6th one may you see 2500 is already given. What is the answer for 7th one? 1.6. Okay. So, in 7th question, what is the simple interest that I need to substitute? Here? which how do you get 1700? A minus P, 10,200 minus 8,500, which is 1,700. So indirectly is given, so you have to compute it on your own. Is equal to 8,500 into T. T is what you need to compute into R. What is the value of R here? Same, 12.5 divided by 100. See, either he can give it as 12.5 or sometimes he will give it as 12 1 by 2 in mixed fraction. But both are one and the same for me, right? 25 by 2. Even if you substitute 25 by 2, you will get the same answer. Okay. Now the value of T would be 1700 divided by 85 into 12.5. You should get, okay, 17 goes 5 times actually. If I write this as 17 into 100, 17 goes 5 times. 100 by how much? 62.5. How much you are getting? 1.6. Please remember, this is 1, this is not 1 year 6 months. Exact 1.6, this is 1.6 years. Please remember, this is not 1 year 6 months. This is 1.6 years. So you need, if you want to compute this into months, this will have 1 full year plus 0.6 year. This is not 6 months. Please remember, this is not 1 year 6 months. It is 1.6 year. Why you need to be very clear? Because 1 year will not have 10 months, but it will have 12 months. So whenever I am writing decimal, you will write 1.2, 1.3, so on up to 1.9, and this will come 2. There is no 1.11 and 1.12. So, but months will be going on till 12. So, whenever you are getting an answer, please remember this is not months. This is still years only. So, whatever is the decimal value, which is the remaining year, if you want to convert that into months, you need to multiply the decimal value into 12 to get the months. Because 1 year is equal to 12 months. So, 0.6 will give you. So, which effectively means 1 full year and 7 months, 7.2 months. If you want to again compute, it will come 6 days because into 30 if I do 0.2, which you don't have to do again because options may, I think they have rounded off to 7. So, which is effectively 1 year and 7 months. So, please remember this value is not months. This is nothing but years which you need to compute into months. Okay, right? So, what is the answer? Option 1, 1 year 7 months because rounded off to the nearest answer, okay, right? So that months to years computation is something that you need to watch out for, okay? That is the only mistake that you can possibly do in this exercise. Otherwise, there is no chance for doing mistakes also here, okay? All you need to watch out for is when you are computing this, you will get the answer in years. If you are getting an integer like 2 years, 3 years, it's okay. But if you are not getting an integer, if you are getting a decimal value like 1.6, that 0.6 you need to convert into months if the answer is given in months. If he already gave you 1.6 years, you can just mark it. But if he gave you in months, you need to compute. For example, if I gave you 1.5 years, what will it be? 1 year, how many months? 6 months. Why? Because 0.5 into 12 will give you 6. If I give you 1.8 years, what does it mean? Tell me the nearest value. 1 year and how many months? 1.8 into 12. 9.6. So 10 months. I'll round it off to the nearest value because it's greater than 0.5. So I'll round it off to the next possible number, right? So whatever you have the decimal part, which is this, after decimal whatever you have, multiply into 12, you will get the number of months. For example, if I say 1.9 years, what will be your answer? 1 year, 10.8, so it is 11 months, like that, right? As simple as that, okay? So whenever you are getting an answer in non-integer form, you need to know how you are converting this decimal part into this months, which is into 12, into 12, nearest answer, into 12. What into 12? This one, only this one, 0.5, 0.6 and 0.8. Okay, right? There are another two questions which you need to watch out for, which is question number 9 and question number 10. So first look at question number 9. Ninth one, same exercise, question number 9. Ninth one. So this is the data that he has given. So you look at the word amount to. Amount to means it is amount. Amount to means that 6200 is your amount as well as 7400 is your amount. So how much you invested, he did not tell you. But whatever money you invested, after 2 years it became 6200. And the same amount if you have invested for 3 years, it would have become 7400. Now the challenge is, this problem is a simple interest problem, not a compound interest problem. So if I want to use my formula, simple interest is equal to PTR by 100. First you should be clear, what is the principal, what is the time period, what is the rate of interest and what is the simple interest. Now if I want to use the formula using this part first, where will I put this 6200? Because there is no way of amount here. There is no value of A. So where do I put that value? How much money you invested? You don't know. Let us assume P, principal. How much money you got after 2 years? 6,200. What is the interest that you earned? 6,200 minus P. This will be your simple interest. Yes? So on the left hand side, always you need to substitute the simple interest only in that formula. How much money you invested? P. Whatever value you have started and this is what you have ended with. So what is the additional amount is your interest. So interest is equal to P into, what is the value of T? 2 into R by 100. This is your first equation. First equation. So tell me similarly, what is the second equation? 7400 minus P is equal to P into 3 into R by, everyone fine with this? Any doubts? Here you should not put 62 and 74, you should put 6200 minus P because it is only interest. If the problem was compound interest, directly you can put because it is amount is equal to. Here it is interest is equal to, that is the only difference. So I think same way you can just divide now. Division is the best process whenever you are solving problems like this. If you divide these two equations, this will get cancelled, this will also get cancelled in one go. So you will get 6200 minus P divided by 7400 minus P is equal to P into R, P into R, 100, 100 will also get cancelled. You are left with 2 by 3, very simple. Cross multiply, you will get the value of P. Once you get the value of P, check from the options. If there is only one answer which is having that unique P, mark it. If you have two answers with the same value of P, then find out the value of R also. Otherwise, not required. But simplify and tell me what is the answer you are getting. But for now, compute both the value of P and R, both. Okay, so ensure that all of you carry your own Calc. Okay, you should do the calculation in the class. You should not leave it for some other day. How much? 3800. Fair enough. Similarly, find out the value of R. You can substitute the value of P either here or here in one of the two equations and find out what is the value of R. Okay? So, you got the value of P as 3800. Check if you are getting the same answer, each one of you. Okay? Right? So, if I cross multiply, let me simplify. 62 into 3, 186. So, 18600 minus 3P is equal to 14800 minus 2P. So, P is equal to 186, yeah, 3800. Perfect. Correct. The value of P is 3800. Substitute the value of P either here or here and tell me what is the value of R. Ideally, it should be option A only, but please verify before you mark it, because you also have an option called D, none of these. So, you should be careful. You may not get the same answer, right? So, simplify it and find out the value of R also. Either use this equation or this equation, whichever you feel comfortable. Once you get the value of P, substitute in equation 1. If I take it as equation 1, 6200 minus 3800 is equal to 3800 into 2 into R by 100. So, 6200 minus 3800, you will get 2400 is equal to 3800 into 2 into R by 100. R is equal to 2400 divided by 38 into 2, which is 76, where you are getting 31 point how much? 57%. Okay, right? Fine. So, what you need to figure out is what value you will put in LHS. That is the only question. Never put the value of A in your LHS in simple interest question, because it always means the only the interest, not the amount. Okay. So, look at one last question in this exercise, which is 10th one, which is like what we have started with today. So, solve the 10th question, then we will look at some questions on compound interest. 10th one. Tenth question, a sum of money doubles itself in 10 years, the number of years it would triple itself, that means the original value itself. What would be your answer? Yes, sum of money, what is that money? I don't know. But this money is doubling itself in 10 years. Now, I want this P to become 3P in how many years? This is the question. Now, I invested P. And I got 2P. So, how much extra I got? P. This is the principal, this is the amount. So, the interest that you got extra is P. This is what I got extra. So, for getting this extra P, how many years it took? 10 years. Now, if you have invested P and if you want to get 3P, the extra amount that you want to get is 2P. For 1P, it took you 10 years. For 2Ps, it will take you. Because it is simple interest. Okay, fine. Okay, right. So now let us look at the case of compound interest. Okay, now open your next exercise. I'll explain the concept of effective rate of interest tomorrow, but let us do some basic problems of compound interest. So let's start the cases where you are doing compounding more than one time in a year, where you are doing compounding quarterly or half yearly. Let us start with those questions. So, like in exercise 4B, please look at question number 10 to start with, 10th one. Question number 10 in exercise 4B. So, in this entire exercise of 4B, the formula that I am going to use, amount is equal to principal into 1 plus I whole power n, or 1 plus r by 100 whole power n, okay, where I is equal to r by 100. This is a regular formula, or amount is equal to p into 1 plus r by 100 whole power n. If I want to adjust this formula, if I am doing compounding for 2 years, it will be r by 2 and 2 into n. If I am doing it for, this is half yearly. If I am doing this formula for quarterly, I will do r by 4 by 100 into power 4 n. This is quarterly. Two cases, maximum two cases, because computation will become more difficult if I go monthly. It will be more difficult because I have to do 12 times. So ideally you can restrict yourself for 2 and 4 in the given questions that are shared with you. Okay. So let's start with question number 10. Look at question number 10. So what is that 16,000 in the question number 10? What is it? Principal. The rupees 16,000 that is given to you is principal. Rate of interest is given as 10% per annum. Please look at, it is always P dot A dot. So when you are substituting the value, you should take how much? 5. Because you are doing the compounding every 6 months. He is taking half yearly. So in question number 10, I have to use this formula. So what will I put? Amount is equal to, what is the principal? 16,000 into 1 plus, what is the value of R? 5, actually 10, but here it will be 10 by 2 because you are doing 2 times in a year. So it will be 5 by 100 whole power how many times? What is the value of, what is the value of N? 1.5. 2 into 1.5. Whatever you are dividing here, 10 by 2 into 2. Whatever you are dividing here, you should multiply with this value. So effectively, this will become 16,000 into 1 plus 5 by 100 whole power 3. 2 into 1.5 will become 3. So you need to compute this value, which will be 16,000 into, if you want to simplify, 5 ones are 5, 20s are. 1 plus 1 by 20. 21 by 20, 21 by 20, into 21. I am just writing it. You may not do it this way because you have Calc. You can just do the simplification easily because you know simplification. How much you are getting? Total value? 18,522. So please remember, whatever value you get, what is the value that you are going to get?
Amount.
In compound interest, you will always get the amount only. That means whatever money you invested, whatever final value you are going to get, that will come. But the question is only asking you what is the interest. So after investing 16,000, you end up getting 18,522. So the additional value you got, compound interest, how much? That is the difference. Okay, fine. Okay. So which is your option B? 2,522. Option B, enough? B. B for Bombay, 2,522, okay. Okay, then after this, once you are done with this, you have one more question where half yearly concept is there. Once you are done with question number 10, look at question number 5. Fifth one is also concept of half yearly, even fifth one. Question number 5. 5th one. So directly he gave you the amount as 1000. Time is given is 2 years. Rate of interest is given as 6% per annum. Compound interest payable half yearly. Then the value of P. Yes, so this is what you have used, principal into 1 plus R. R is actually 6%. Since I am doing it 2 times in a year, by 2. Time is already given as 2 years, so into 2. So whatever is this division and whatever is this multiplication, both are one and the same. Okay, so effectively this will translate into P into 1 plus 3 by 100 whole power 4. 1.03. So the value of P is equal to 1000 divided by 1.03 whole power 4. So use your calci and tell me what is the value of P. How much? 888.4. Okay. So round off to the nearest answer. Whatever is the answer that you see in your options. Okay, then you should get option A, right? Okay. So the difference between question number 5 and question number 10 is, in case of question number 10, he gave you the principal, you found out what is the amount and then you subtracted that, you get the interest. In case of question number 5, he gave you the amount, final value, he gave you everything, he is asking you to find out the principal. So what is the interest in this case? What is the interest in this case, which is 1000 minus 888 point whatever is your answer, that will give you the additional interest. Okay. So these are the two questions which you have compound interest being done half yearly. Then you have two questions where you have compound interest being done quarterly, which are question number 11 and question number 14. Okay, so we will do only one, let us do 14th one. Question number 14. 1 4. Question number 14. 1 4. Okay, this computation should ideally come to 888.8 if your answer is correct. If the simplification is correct, now it should come closest to your answer. Okay. Then look at question number 14. All of you, 14th. So the moment you read any question, immediately you should understand what are the values that are given. So what is 4000 here?
Principal.
Time is how much? 6 months. So in terms of years, it should be 1 by 2, 6 by 12 or 0.5 or 1 by 2, whatever you may put. And the rate of interest is given for 1 year and the compounding is done every quarterly. So if it is done every quarter in a year, how many times you should do it? 4, right? But in this problem, you will do it only 2 times because you have only 6 months. So what is the amount? Amount is equal to P into 1 plus R by 100 whole power N. Did he give amount? No. What is the principal? 4000. He wants amount or interest in the problem? Interest. So once you get amount, you know how to compute the interest. Okay. So what is the value of R? 12 by 4. Because you are doing it every quarter. Don't forget that 6 months. Keep it aside. How? What is the rate of interest? 12% per year. How many times you are doing compounding every quarter? So in a year, how many quarters are there? 4. So take it by 4. So don't look at any other stuff first. First freeze this value as R is equal to 12 by 4 by 100. Now come to here. What is the value of n given? The value of n is given is 6 months. 6 months is nothing but 6 by 12. This is in terms of years. Whatever I multiply divided here, I should multiply with the same value, then it will be adjusted. Okay. So, what is the rate of interest? Not 12 by 2, but it is 12 by 4. Because you are doing compounding 3-4 times in a year, every 3 months. So, it is 12 by 4. Time is given in months. So, first convert that into years. Whatever you divided, you multiply. You will be able to find out your final answer, which is 4000 into, what is this? 3. 1.03 again, just like the previous problem. Okay. So, 2 is what you are getting. Or simply you can do this. In a 6 month period, you have 2 quarters. So, obviously, you know this is 2, any which way you can compute. So, what is the value that you are getting? No, it will go to this big. It is not 1.3, it is 1.03.
4,000.
This is the final amount. Correct. So, the final value, that means after investing 4,000, how much you are getting? 4,243.60 rupees. If my computation is correct. Hence, he is not interested in the amount, he is only interested in the interest. This value minus whatever is the money that you invested will give you the interest, which is 240.60 rupees. See, you have both option A and option C. But here the answer is option A. So, you have to compute till the last bit. Okay. So, don't round it off. See what are the options based on that you should mark. Okay. Right. Next. Fair enough. So, you should be absolutely clear what adjustment you are doing and what you are doing here. There should be no confusion at all, because there is no room for confusion, because these are very simple concepts. Okay. Next. Okay. So, the answer is 240.60 rupees, which is option A. Now, coming to using the same concept of compound interest, probably in your accounts you would have heard something related to depreciation. So, keep accounts aside for the time being. The word depreciation, what does it mean? Increasing or decreasing?
Decreasing.
Or, for example, I will also give you some concept of successive discounts. Okay. For example, I walk into Central. Okay. Right. So, they say today they are holding a discount offer. Okay. 50% plus 5%, for example, they say me that. So, does it mean they will give me 55%, or first they will give me 50% and again then 5%? Generally, the word successive discounting means that you are giving 2 discounts one after the other. For example, if I make a bill of, let us say, 12,000 rupees, okay, the shopping mall says they will give me a discount of 50% and or plus, whatever, and or plus, both are same, 50% and on the remaining bill they will give me 20%, for example. This is called successive discounting. So, effectively they are not giving me 70%. They are giving you 50%. On that they will give you 20%. This is called successive discounting. Why? Because 70% is very high. Now, you see this 12,000, how much they are giving discount? 50%, which is remove half of this. So, you are subtracting 6,000. So, you end up getting a bill of 6,000 after first discount. On this they will give you 20%. So, you know how to compute 20% into 20 by 100. So, you know you will get it as 1200. Right. So, in the 6000 you will subtract 1200 and you will end up paying 4800. So, this is called successive discount. So, if you want to use successive discounting concept, okay, you can use the same case of compound interest formula. Amount is equal to P into 1 plus R by 100 whole power N. Same formula you can use, but since it is not profit, it is discount. Instead of plus, you have to use minus, and in place of R you will put D, discount. You are giving discount, but obviously this has to be done every 1 year, right? So, in the first case, what is the total bill amount? 12,000. On 12,000, how much discount you give? So, how much he is paying? Out of the total value, you are removing 50%. How much he is paying? Another 50%, right? So, 1 minus 50% you gave 50/100. Agreed? It's like 1 plus R by 100, it is 1 minus D by 100. So effectively you are giving a discount of 50%. So he is paying you remaining 50%. So now this discount is over, which is coming to 6000. Agreed? Whatever you compute now, you will get 6000 only. On 6000, how much discount you are giving? So how much he is paying in percentage? If you are giving him 20% discount, he is paying you 80%, which is 1 minus 20/100. Instead of 1 plus R by 100, I am using 1 minus D by 100, where I am giving you discount 2 times, which is 12,000 into 1 minus 50/100. On whatever value you get after first discount, on this I am giving you 20%. See, either way, whether you compute 20% and subtract from it, or whether you write 1 minus 20/100, you will get the same answer. Instead of doing it in 2 steps, I am saying do it in 1 step only, straight away, which will directly give you 4,800 once you simplify. So instead of computing it separately and then subtracting, I am doing the same step. What if I split this into 2 parts, what you will get? 6000 minus 6000 into 20/100. Same calculation I have shown you earlier, where I have computed 20% and subtracted, you are getting 6800. So instead of doing this, I am saying write it in the brackets form using your own formula. So whenever I am using the concept of depreciation, instead of using plus, I will use, instead of R, I will put D, or D or whatever value, whatever is the rate of depreciation that you will put, power N will remain. If you are depreciating your machine for 2 years, for example, the initial purchase value of a machine, for example, I purchase this bike today, let's say Honda Activa, the value is 50,000. Value of the scooter, excluding registration and all, because the value of scooter is more important, for example. So I purchase this Activa at 50,000, the rate of depreciation is 20%, for example. Rate of depreciation is 20%. That means, depreciation means every year the value of that scooter will keep reducing by 20%. Now the question is, whether this 20% value depreciation will happen on the original amount or on the outstanding amount. So that means every year 20% you will reduce from the original amount, or will you reduce 20% of whatever is remaining in that year? Okay, so what does this formula indicate? This is compound interest or simple interest? Compound interest. That means depreciation is also applicable on the outstanding value. That means if I am depreciating the value of my scooter 20% for 3 years, now if I want to know what is the value of my scooter after 3 years, what will I do? What is the purchase value of my scooter? I will put 50,000. What is the depreciation rate? 20%. How many years I am doing depreciation? 3 years. Now the only difference here is, whenever you are doing compound interest, the amount will always be more than principal, because interest is getting accumulated. But in case, this value will always be less than 50,000, because you are depreciating it. That's the only difference. If you have plus now, obviously this will be more. So this is your scrap value. This is what we call as scrap value of your, this is the original value, this is the final value. The final value will always be less than original value, because the value of your asset is actually reducing. That is the only difference. So in whenever you have the word depreciation formula, you just need to modify your formula as 1 plus R by 100 whole power n into 1 minus D by 100 whole power n. This is your original value, initial value, this is your final value. Whatever terminology you use, keep it simple. Principal is today, amount is in future, this is the rate of depreciation, this is the number of years for which you are depreciating. Okay, let us do one problem in your exercise, which is question number question number 8. All, if you look at question number 8, last question for today. Look at question number 8. So you have to use your CalC now, because it's a big calculation. Question number 8, exercise 4B. So in this question, what is the value of principal that you'll substitute? 10,000. Time?
10 years.
Rate of interest? 10%. 10 by 100. R is equal to 10. So effectively you are writing 10,000 into 1 minus 10 by 100 whole power 10. So this will be a lengthy calculation. Okay. Option? Okay, fair enough. So which is 10,000 into 1 minus 10 by 100 whole power 10. So investment, that means the value of the asset is 10,000, rate of depreciation is 10%, and the depreciation is happening for 10 years. Now I am interested in the scrap value. So you put it as S. Scrap value is equal to initial value into 1 minus D by 100 whole power N, which is 10,000 into 0.9 whole power 10. I don't know whatever is that value. How much you are getting final? 3, 4, whatever it is. That means if you want to sell your asset at the end of 10 years, the scrap value of your asset will be 3486.78 or whatever is that computation. Okay. So ensure you do it till the last digit at least. If you feel that options are very close, before solving the problem, you should look at the options first. If you see the options are very close, then while you are doing it, do it very carefully. If you feel that options are little far, then you can take round it off to the nearest value. Okay. So you are getting option A. Everyone? Yes. So this is what the concept of depreciation. What is happening when the value is decreasing continuously. Okay. So tomorrow we look at other concepts of compound interest and then we will start annuity. Okay. So any problems that, so I suggest that all of you solve the remaining problems in exercise 4A, and whatever is the theory given between exercise 4A and 4B. So which is starting from page 4.9 till page 4.16. Okay. Whatever the examples given in between with respect to compounding quarterly, compounding half yearly. In page 4.17, you have effective rate of interest that I'll explain tomorrow. So starting from page 4.9 to page 4.16, whatever are the examples that are given, please practice those examples today. Okay, so that you will feel comfortable. And tomorrow we'll look at effective rate of interest, remaining questions, and then we'll go into annuity. Okay, so annuity will take one and a half day. So ideally, by this Thursday, we should be in a position to finish off this chapter. Okay, so but ensure that you keep practicing parallelly. So any doubts you have, we'll discuss whenever you are done with the session. Okay, so we are done.